The Northern Yuan Dynasty, or simply the Northern Yuan, refers to the Mongol regime based in Mongolia homeland after the fall of the Yuan Dynasty in China in 1368, until the emergence of the Qing Dynasty founded by the Manchus in the 17th century. The Northern Yuan Dynasty began with the end of Mongol rule in China and retreat of the Mongols to the Mongolian steppe. And this period was marked by factional struggles and the often only nominal role of the Great Khan. Dayan Khan and Mandukai Khatun reunited the entire Mongol nation in the 15th century. However, the former's distribution of his empire among his sons and relatives as fiefs caused the decentralization of the imperial rule. Despite this decentralization, there was a remarkable concord within the Dayan Khanid aristocracy, and intra-Chingashid civil war remained unknown until the reign of Ligadan Khan, who saw much of his power weakened in his quarrels with the Mongol tribes and was defeated by the Manchus. The last 60 years of this period are marked by intensive penetration of Tibetan Buddhism into Mongolian society. Name. The period is known by various names, including the Northern Yuan Dynasty, or simply the Northern Yuan, although it sometimes refers to the period before 1388, when Tofus Tema was murdered near the Tuol River. The term Northern Yuan is derived from the corresponding term in the Chinese language. The Mongols held the name Great Yuan in the early period of this dynasty as in the earlier Yuan dynasty, but they stopped claiming the title Great Yuan since the 15th century except during the reigns of, for example, Dayan Khan. However, in the English language the term Northern Yuan is still used to cover the whole period for historiography reasons. Apart from the name of Great Yuan, in the early period, the Mongols called their nation Ikh Mongol Uels, meaning the Great Mongol State. It is also referred to as the Post-Imperial Mongolia, Mongol Khaganate, Mongolian Khaganate, Mongol Khanate or Mongolian Khanate in some modern sources. Although most of these English terms can also refer to the Mongol Empire or the Yuan Dynasty in the 13th and the 14th centuries. In Mongolian chronicles this period is also known as the 40 and the 4, meaning 40 Tumen Eastern Mongols and 4 Tumen Western Mongols. Furthermore, Mongolian historiography also use the term period of political disunion and period of small Khagans, etc. History. Retreating to Mongolia, the Mongols under Kublai Khan of the Mongol Empire, a grandson of Genghis Khan, had conquered all of China by eliminating the Southern Song Dynasty in 1276 and destroyed the last Chinese resistance in 1279. The Mongol Yuan Dynasty ruled all of China for about a century. However, the Mongols dominated North China for more than 140 years, starting from the time when the Jurchen Jin dynasty was annihilated. Nevertheless, when the Han Chinese people in the countryside suffered from frequent natural disasters such as droughts, floods and the ensuing famine since the late 1340s, and the government's lack of effective policy led to a loss of the support from people. In 1351, the Red Turban Rebellion started and grew into a nationwide turmoil. Eventually, Zhu Yuanzhang, a Chinese peasant, established the Ming Dynasty in South China, and sent an army toward the Yuan capital Khan Bali Kordadu in 1368. Tofon Tima, the last ruler of the Yuan, fled north to Shangdu from Dadu in 1368 after the approach of the forces of the Ming dynasty. He had tried to regain Dadu, but eventually failed. He died in Yingchang 2 years later. Yingchang was seized by the Ming shortly after his death. The Yuan remnants retreated to Mongolia after the fall of Yingchang to the Ming dynasty in 1370, where the name Great Yuan was formally carried on. Known as the Northern Yuan dynasty or simply Northern Yuan, the Genghisid rulers of the Northern Yuan also buttressed their claim on China, and held tenaciously to the title of Emperor of the Great Yuan to resist the Ming, who had by this time become the real ruler of China. According to the traditional Chinese political orthodoxy, There could be only one legitimate dynasty whose rulers were blessed by heaven to rule as emperor of China. So the Ming also denied the Yuan remnants legitimacy as emperors of China. Although the Ming did consider the previous Yuan which it had succeeded to be a legitimate dynasty, the Ming army pursued the Mongol forces of the northern Yuan into Mongolia in 1372, but were defeated by the latter under Ayushridhar and his general Khotima. In 1375, Nagachu, a Mongol official of Bailiktu Khan in Liaoyang province, invaded Liaodong with aims of restoring the Mongols to power. Although he continued to hold southern Manchuria, Nagachu finally surrendered to the Ming dynasty in 1387-88 after a successful diplomacy of the latter. The Yuan loyalists under Kublai Prince Baisala Wurma in Yunnan and Gai Zhou were also destroyed by the Ming in 1381-82. About 70,000 Mongols were taken prisoner and the Mongol capital Karakorum was sacked and destroyed. It effectively destroyed the power of the Khan's Mongols for a long time, and allowed the Western Mongols to become supreme. Field guns and hand cannons were used by the Northern Yuan army. Rise of the Oirats in 1388. The Northern Yuan throne was taken over by Yasuda, a descendant of Arik Boka, instead of the descendants of Kublai Khan. After the death of his master Togus Tima, Gunashiri, a descendant of Chagatai Khan, founded his own small state called Karadel in Hami. The following century saw a succession of Chingashid rulers, many of whom were mere figureheads put on the throne by those warlords who happened to be the most powerful. From the end of the 14th century there appeared designations such as Period of Small Kings for this period in modern historiography. On one side stood the Oirats in the west against the Eastern Mongols, while the Oirats drew their side to the descendants of Arik Boka and other princes. Arugte of the Asud supported the old Yuan Khans. Another force was the House of Ogade, who briefly attempted to reunite the Mongols under their rule. The Mongols split into three main groups: Western Mongols, the Mongol groups under the Uriankhai in northeast, and the Eastern Mongols between the two. The Uriankhai and some Borjigin princes surrendered to the Ming dynasty in the 1390s. The Ming divided them into three guards: Doyan, Tainin and Fuyu. Periods of conflict with the Ming dynasty intermingled with periods of peaceful relations with border trade. In 1402, Orugtima Khan abolished the name Great Yuan. He was however defeated by Oljetima Khan, the protege of Tamerlane, in 1403. Most of the Mongol noblemen under Arugte Chingsang sided with Oljetima. Under Yongle, the Ming dynasty intervened aggressively against any overly powerful leader, exacerbating the Mongol-Oirat conflict. In 1409 Oljetima and Arugte crushed a Ming army, so that Yongle personally attacked the two on the Kurline River. After the death of Oljetima, the Oirats under their leader Abahamu enthroned an Arik Bokid, Delbig Khan, in 1412. Although the Ming encouraged the Oirats to fight against the Eastern Mongols, they withdrew their support when the Oirats became powerful. After 1417 Arugte became dominant again, and Yongle campaigned against him in 1422 and 1423. Bahamu's successor Toan pushed Arugte east of the Greater Khingan Range in 1433. The Oirats killed him in the west of Bayoto the next year. Arugte's ally Adai Khan made a last stand in Agena before he was murdered too. Toan died in the very year of his victory over Adai. His son Azen brought the Oirats to the height of their power. Under his Chingashid puppet Khans, he drove back the Mofulist and Monarchs and crushed the three guards, Karadel and the Jurchen. In 1449 he captured the Ming's Zhengtong Emperor, bringing about a whole-scale collapse of the Ming northern defense line. Azen and his father ruled as Taishis of Chingashid Khans, but after executing the rebellious Khan Taesung and his brother Akbar Jan in 1453, Azen took the title Khan himself. He was, however, soon overthrown by his Qing Sang Alug. His death broke up the role of the Uirats until they revived in the early 17th century. From Essen's death to 1481, different warlords of the Karchen, the Belgatiards and Ordos fought over succession and had their Chingishi Khans enthroned. The Mongolian chroniclers call some of them Nuggars and they might have some ties with the Hami Oasis. During his reign, Mandu Yiling Khan effectively won over most of the Mongol warlords before he died in 1478. Restoration, second reunion. Manjul's young Khatun Mandukai proclaimed a boy named Betamonka, the new Khan, as a descendant of Genghis Khan, took the title Dayan, meaning the Great Yuan, with reference to the Yuan dynasty. Mandukai and Dayan Khan overthrew Oirat supremacy. At first the new rulers operated with the Taishi system. The Taishis mostly ruled the Yellow River Mongols. However, one of them killed Dayan Khan's son and revolted when Dayan Khan appointed his son, Jinong Uluzbold, over them. Dayan Khan finally defeated the southwestern Mongols in 1510 with the assistance of his allies, Ani Bolad Wang and the four Oirats. Making his another son Jinong, he abolished old Yuan court titles of Taishi, Qingshang, Pingchan and Qiyuan. The Ming dynasty closed border trade and killed his envoys. Dayan invaded China and subjugated the three guards, tributaries of the Ming. The Oirats assisted his campaign in China. The high point of Mongol power came again in 1517, when Dayan Khan moved on Beijing itself. The Mongolian armies raided the Ming dynasty not only in the north, but also in the hitherto quiet west. The Ming's Zhengde emperor lost his protectorate Hami to the Turpans at the same time. In 1542, Dayan Khan defeated Chinese troops just before his death. The Tumed Mongols ruled in the Ordos region and they gradually extended their domain into northeastern Qinghai. By that time, the northern Yuan stretched from the Siberian tundra and Lake Baikal in the north, across the Gobi, to the edge of the Yellow River and south of it into the Ordos. The lands extended from the forests of Manchuria in the east past the Altai Mountains and out onto the steppes of Central Asia. Administrative divisions. Dayan Khan reorganized the eastern Mongols into six tumens as follows. Left wing, Karka Tumen, northern Seven Otog, Katahin, and later added Uriankhai, southern Five Otog, and Hongarid, Chahar Tumen, Obega, Obeganar, Aokan, Dawes, Dervade, Hishigten, Muamyangan, Naiman, Onagud, Huukid, Sunud, Uzumchen, and Urad Uriankhai Tumen. This Tumen was later dissolved. Right wing, Ordos Tumen, Tum Tumen, Yunshibu Tumen, four Tumen Oirats. Chorus, Olitz, Dervud, Koid, Bartud, Talgut, Koshut, Mongol, Baga Mongols and Buryats. The Baga and Buryats later became subject of Karka. They functioned both as military units and as tribal administrative bodies who hoped to receive Taijis, descended from Dayan Khan. Northern Karka people and Uriang Khan were attached to the South Karka of Eastern Inner Mongolia and Doyan Uriang Khan of the Three Guards, respectively. After the rebellion of the Northern Uriankhai people, they were conquered in 1538 and mostly annexed by the Northern Karka. However, his decision to divide the six Tumens to his sons, or Taijis, and local Tabu Nang's sons-in-law of the Taijis created a decentralized system of Borjigin rule that secured domestic peace and outward expansion for a century. Despite this decentralization, there was a remarkable concord within the Dayan Khanid aristocracy. Last reunion by 1540, new regional circles of Chingiside Taijis and local Tabu Nangs of the Taijis emerged in all the former Dayan Khanid domains. The Khagan and the Jinong had titular authority over the three right-wing Tumens. The decentralized peace among the Mongols was based on religious and cultural unity created by Chingishid cults. A series of smallpox epidemics and lack of trade forced the Mongols to repeatedly plunder the districts of China. In 1571, the Ming opened trade with the three right-wing Chumans. The large-scale conversion to Buddhism in the three right-wing Chumans from 1575 on, built on the amity of the Chingishids. Tumen Jizachu Khan appointed a Tibetan Buddhist chaplain of the Karmapa order. In 1580, Northern Kharkha proclaimed their leading Dayan Khanate prince, Abte Khan. Representatives from all Mongols, including Oirats, constituted the court of Tumen Jizachu Khan, who had conquered Kokonur and codified a new law. By the end of the 16th century, the three guards lost their existence as a distinct group. Their Fuyu was absorbed by the Khorchan after they had moved to the Noni River. Two other, Doyan and Tainin, were absorbed by the five Kharkhas. Fall in the 17th century, the Mongols came under the influence of the Manchus, who founded the Qing dynasty. The princes of Khorchan, Yarud and Southern Kharkha, Mongols made a formal alliance with the Manchus from 1612 to 1624. Resenting this suborning of his subjects, Ligadang Khan, the last Khagan in Chahar, unsuccessfully attacked them in 1625. He appointed his officials over the Chumans and formed an elite military band to coerce opposition. The massive rebellion broke out in 1628. The Chahar under Ligadang defeated their combined armies and the Manchu auxiliary at Zhaocheng but fled a large Manchu punitive expedition. Only Tsogt Taiju supported the Great Khan whilst other nobles of Kharkha remained neutral and inactive. Ligadang died on his way to Tibet to punish the Dge Lugspa order in 1634. His son, Ajay Khan, surrendered to the Manchus and was said to give the imperial seal of the Yuan rulers to King Emperor Huang Taiji the next year, ending the Northern Yuan. After the death of Dayan Khan, most of Mongolia came under the rule of descendants of his youngest son, Gurzin Huang Taiji. By the early 17th century, these formed four Khanates, from west to east. The Altan Khans of Khatogoids in the far west, founded by Sholoy Abashi, great-grandson of Jerasandza. The Dzizachu Khans, Khanate founded by Lakor Khan, a cousin of the Altan Khan. The Tashetu Khans at Ulan Bator, founded by Abatai, another grandson. This was the senior branch. The second Khans at the eastern end of modern Mongolia, founded by Sholoy, a great-grandson. In the north, from 1583, Russian adventurers gained control of the forest tribes of Siberia but did not attempt to interfere with the numerous and warlike peoples south of the forests. They had some dealings with the Altan Khan, who is said to have introduced him to Chinese tea. To the east, in 1582 to 1626, Nuraisi unified the tribes of Manchuria. His son, Huang Taiji, consolidated the new state and incorporated parts of Inner Mongolia. At his death, Dorgan became regent for his six-year-old son and was in charge when the Manchus took Beijing and founded the Qing dynasty. To the west, Indus Hungaria. About 1600 to 1620, the Oirats became united under Karakula and formed the Dzungar Khanate. This unification was partly driven by their wars with the Altan Khans. The king completely exterminated one branch of the Bolgigas after an anti-king revolt in 1675 by Ajay's brother Abunai and Abunai's son Borni against the king. The Qing emperors then placed the Chahar Mongols under their direct rule. Aftermath: in 1662, the Altan Khan attacked and put to death his eastern neighbor. This caused the senior Tashetu Khan to drive him out, but he was restored with Dzungar and Qing support. In 1682, he was captured by the next Dzashchu Khan and his Khanate disappeared from history. The loss of the westernmost Kharkha Khanate opened the way for the Dzungars. In 1672, Guldan became Khan of the Dzungars. After conquering the northern Tarim Basin from Kashgar to Hami, he began to dream of uniting the Mongols, although as an Oirat Khan he was of non-Chinggi side lineage, unlike the Khans of the Kharkha Mongols. The Dzungas in the Dzunga Khanate actively tried to resist the Manchu Qing dynasty. The Oirat Dzunga leader Erdeni Batta and Buddhist monk Saya Pandita tried to form an alliance of Oirats and Khakas against the Qing and Russian Empire, drawing up a single legal code for all the Mongols, banning shamanism, and declaring Tibetan Buddhism to be the sole religion of the Mongol peoples. By calling up a Kurultai in 1640, which Dzunga Oirats, Koshat Oirats from Qinghai, Torgut Oirats, Khakha Mongols, and Tibetans attended, Gul'dan allied with the Dzazachu Khan against the Tushatu Khan, who in turn attacked the Dzashchu Khan and then invaded Dzunga territory where he killed one of Gul'dan's brothers. Gul'dan responded by annihilating the Tushatu Khan's army near the Tarim River and plundering the tombs at Karakoram. The Tushatu Khan and the other Khakha leaders fled to Ho'ot of the northeast corner of the Ordos Loop and begged for king help. By 1690, Gul'dan controlled the whole Khakha country as far as the edge of Manchuria and turned south toward Beijing. This direct threat to the king led the Kangxi Emperor to block Gul'dan, who withdrew to the northwest in late 1690. In May 1691, the emperor held a Kurultai at Dolan Nor, where the Khakha chiefs declared themselves vassals of the king emperors. In 1695, Gul'dan moved east again. The emperor sent a massive army and defeated him near Ulaanbaatar. Gul'dan fled with a few followers and later died. Outer Mongolia was thus incorporated into the Qing Empire, and the Khakha leaders returned to Outer Mongolia as Qing vassals. A Qing garrison was installed at Ulaanbaatar. The Qing forces occupied Hami but did not advance into Dzungaria. Oirats later expanded into Tibet and Kazakhstan, and they tried to control all Mongols.